Hello everyone, this is the 6th history tutorial video for class 10. We were continuing with the chapter Rise of Nationalism in Europe, and today we will finish the chapter. While it is easy enough to represent a ruler through a portrait or a statue, how does one go about giving a face to the nation? Artists in the 18th and 19th century, European artists, they found a way out of personifying a nation. What is personification? Personification is any inanimate object you take and then you try to imagine that object as a person. In other words, the artists represented a country as if it was a person. Nations were portrayed as female figures. The female form that was chosen to personify the nation did not stand for any particular woman in real life. Rather, it sought to give the abstract idea of the nation a concrete form. That is, the female figure became an allegory of the nation. The female figure became an equivalent of a nation state. You will remember that the French Revolution artists, they used female allegories to portray ideas like liberty, justice and republic. These ideals were represented through specific objects or symbols. Now, how were the attributes of liberty personified? The attributes of liberty are personified as red cape, okay, broken chain, and justice is depicted how? Justice is depicted like a blindfold woman who covers her eyes and who carries a pair of weighing scales, who carries a weighing scale in her hand. You know, in any court of India, in any symbol of justice, this lady appears with a blindfold around her eyes and a pair of weighing scales in her hand. And probably in some representations, a sword in another hand. If you have seen the film Justice League, if you remember the Justice League scene where Wonder Woman enters, she was first standing on top of a statue. That statue was the statue of Lady Justice. So that was the female form of justice which European artists gave during the French Revolution. Similar female allegories were invented by artists in the 19th century to represent the nation. Like, for example, in France. In France, she was christened as Marianne. Marianne is a popular Christian name which underlined the idea of a people's nation. Her characteristics were drawn from those of liberty and the republic. The red cap, the tricolor, the cockade. Statue of Marianne was erected in public square to remind the public of the national symbol of unity and to persuade them to identify with it. Marianne images were marked on coins and stamps. Similarly, if you look at the history of India, if you look at the personification of India, the history of personification of India, you will find that India is generally depicted, or India is generally represented by a mother figure who we know as Bharat Mata. This Bharat Mata, the concept of a mother who is in shackles by the British, the shackles of bondage by the British Empire, the freedom of the mother mattered the most to its children, to its sons. So the freedom fighters, therefore, they imagined themselves as the sons of this mother, Bharat Mata, and they imagined India as their mother. If this Bharat Mata image was first, we get the image in writing in Bankim Chandra Chatterjee's novels. Later, the painting was made of Bharat Mata by Abanindranath Tagore, the nephew of Rabindranath Tagore. How is nationalism related to imperialism? By the last quarter of the 19th century, nationalism no longer retained its idealistic, liberal, democratic nature, but became a narrow creed with limited and greedy ends. During this period, nationalist groups became increasingly intolerant of each other and ever ready to go to war. They were always fighting with each other in name of nationalism. The major European powers manipulated the nationalist aspirations of the people to further their own imperialist aims, to further their own interests. The most serious source of nationalist tension after 1871 was an area called the Balkans. The Balkan area was a region of geographical and ethnic variation comprising of modern-day Romania, Bulgaria, Albania, Greece, Macedonia, Croatia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Slovenia, Serbia, and Montenegro, whose inhabitants were broadly known as Slavs. Now, a large part of Balkans were under the control of the Ottoman Empire for a long time, the Turkish Empire. The spread of the ideas of romantic nationalism in the Balkans, together with the disintegration of the Turkish Empire, made this region very explosive. All through the 19th century, the Turkish Empire had sought to strengthen itself through modernization and internal reforms, but with very limited success. One by one, its European subject nationalities broke away from its control and declared independence. The Balkan area, with all these small nationalities and small ethnic groups like the Bosnians, the Croatians, the Greeks, Macedonians, Serbians, etc., etc., and also Muslims in a few number, all of them were very eager to carve out their own nationalistic identity, their own independent nation state. So they were always fighting with each other. And this area in particular became a proxy war zone for bigger powers, like for Russia, for Austria, okay, for Germany, for France, because they, in the name of helping these small states, they thought that if by helping them we could control this area, then I would be becoming more powerful than the others. So that was also their interest at play in this area. So this became a proxy war zone between the bigger powers like the Russians, the Austrians, the Germans. Now all of this factor led to a series of wars, and finally that intense period of unrest, finally that culminated into the First World War. So nationalism aligned with imperialism led Europe to the First World War in 1914, which was clearly a disaster. But meanwhile, many countries of the world which had been colonized by European powers began to oppose this imperial domination. The anti-imperial movements that developed everywhere, they were in a sense nationalist, because they all struggled to form independent nation states free from the influence of European colonizers. They forged in confrontation with imperialism. European ideas of nationalism was nowhere replicated. The ideas which were European nationalism, which depicted European nationalism, nationhood, the sectarian, the narrow-mindedness of the European countries in the later half of the 19th century, that kind of nationalism was nowhere to be seen in the world except for Europe. But people everywhere, people of the colonized countries, they organized, they developed their own specific version of nationalism. But the idea that societies should be organized into nation states, that idea came to be accepted as natural and universal. So the idea that nation state as an independent sovereign country should exist in all the parts of the world, that idea was respected, that idea was believed in by the nationalists of all the countries. So in a way, the nationalism that we see growing from the ruins of the French Revolution in the first half of the 19th century, that nationalism was actually replicated in the other parts of the world by the colonized countries. So that's it. We have finished this chapter. Question answers will be done later. Question answers will be done when the school reopens. For now, we are sticking with only completing the chapters. In the next tutorial video, I am going to start the second chapter of this of your syllabus. Till then, bye.